All right, another episode of Yankees and Gravy. Thanks for listening. It's been a while. I think the last one was Halloween. Now it is approaching Thanksgiving, just less than 48 hours away. Hope everybody has a wonderful Thanksgiving. Wanted to go over a few things. Guys, honestly, I hate this time of year. There's really, I'm not a scoop guy. I don't run around chasing scoops, trying to break stories or anything like that. All I really want to do is kind of be more reactive than anything else. All that there is to react to right now, basically, is trade stuff. So, I don't know, and signing stuff like that, just off-season hot stove stuff. I mean, there's nothing really that hot about the stove this year, to be honest with you. Not to de-promote my own broadcast, but we'll talk about a few things. We'll talk about a few of that stuff, and the top 10 list this week is going to be top 10 Yankees of what I call the dark years, the dark ages, or whatever you want to, however you want to describe it. The years between, I'm going to say, basically 1981 to 1994, 95. There are some crossover players that you'll see that are championship caliber players, you know, whether it's the 70s or 1980, you know, playoff teams of the Yankees. And I'm excluding players that had a key role in the 96 World Series Yankees and above, even though there are some crossover. Some of the guys in the mid-90s did play on the World Series teams. Discounted guy, like, for example, guys like Jim Leyritz and Bernie Williams are not on this list because they were around for some of the lean years, but they did contribute to championship teams, so they're championship players, and I'm excluding them. The best of the losers is basically what I'm talking about, and there's a top 10 list for that. But let's get into it right now. I guess what they were talking about, some little chatter came between this guy, Jair Jurgens, for Nunez. I mean, it's been since deaded by Cashman as well as the Braves. They say they deny it. Don't waste your breath was the quote that Cashman said. Honestly, I kind of liked it. I don't know. Cashman's a stubborn guy, man. I mean, he's not going to trade Nunez because he's not going to admit that he messed up by not trading him when he could have got Cliff Lee. Maybe if Nunez was part of that deal, he could have got Cliff Lee in 2010. So, I mean, he's not going to do it. He's also saying that they think that Jurgens might have a bad knee, but, man, that kid can pitch, and he might have been pretty good on this team. I was a little worried about him becoming another Javier Vasquez, but I think for Nunez, I mean, I don't know. I like Nunez's bat. What do you want me to tell you? He's got a good live bat, but really, I do not ever remember in all my years of watching baseball, watching a professional baseball player look that confused in the field. I really haven't. I mean, they're going to say he's going to get better or whatever. They're going to work on it with him. Great, but I don't care. I mean, I've just never seen anybody that bad in the field. I've never seen anybody make that many errors in key spots, too. And you can't have that on a championship baseball team. Looks like Darvish is not going to happen. He hasn't even posted yet. His father is weighing in, saying that there's even a 50-50 chance that he even will. They don't like the whole system. I mean, I don't know. I don't know much about it, but the system is the system. They have to post, and then I guess there's a whole bidding system for major league players to be able to even talk to the guy. Crazy, but what are you going to do? But I don't know. There's another unknown guy. You don't know what the hell this guy's going to do. I mean, you talk about going from the NL to the AL being a risk. Coming from Japan to the major leagues is even a bigger risk. I'm not going to lose any sleep if we don't get Darvish. So I guess they're announcing the new playoff system. They added a wild card. I guess the real good teams are going to like this. Teams that are perennial division winners like the Yankees. There'll be another wild card so that the two wild card teams will have a one-game playoff. Division winners, obviously the advantage to that is that they'll be able to get a little rest. They'll also be able to set up their rotation the way they want it so that they can put their best foot forward in the division series, which is still going to be five games, which is still kind of annoying too. That's a five-game series, man. I don't know. I don't like the five-game series. It's short. You know what I mean? I don't always think the best team wins. But what the hell are you going to do? It's not always going to be perfect. And it is what it is. Also, the Astros are going to go to the AL. Now, I think that's going to happen in 2013, they said. It makes sense. I don't know why they picked the Astros. I have no idea. Maybe somebody knows. But what that's going to do is balance out the league so that there's 15 teams in each league. Talking about Bobby V to the Sox. It's not a Yankee situation, but, I mean, anything that involves the hated Boston Red Sox is a Yankee situation. So, yeah, I mean, I'd be concerned. I wouldn't want to see Bobby V go to the Sox. The guy, aside from knowing baseball, yeah, he's a hothead, he's a whack job. And like somebody said, I think, in one of the articles, I mean, it doesn't usually end good for Bobby. I mean, he usually melts down or something happens or does something stupid, says something stupid, pisses somebody off. So he usually ends bad wherever he goes, but he usually goes on a run. I mean, that 2000 Mets team was not an overly talented team. Bobby's got a swagger. Bobby's got experience. Bobby automatically commands a certain level of respect. So the minute that the Red Sox get Bobby Valentine, they're automatically a better team, in my opinion. Verlander, MVP. A lot of people don't like it. A lot of people say the pitcher should never be the MVP. I do not have a problem with this. I don't like a pitcher to be in the running every year, but once in a while it's okay. I think like maybe you send a message, you know what I mean? If there's not a clear-cut offensive player, because I think that's another reason why Verlander might have gotten it too. I think a lot of these players canceled each other out as far as offensive MVP candidates. Either way, so I think Verlander deserves it. Also, I'm okay with it when there is a performance by a pitcher that is just that completely dominating. I mean, he deserves it. And, you know, if once every 10 years a pitcher's going to get it because they're that good, I do not necessarily have a problem with that. Granderson did finish fourth overall. He did have three first-place votes, and he's the only Yankee with first-place votes at all. Cano got a couple of second-place votes, and CC got a couple of, I think, fourth or fifth-place votes or whatever. But that's basically all there is to speak of as far as that goes. Talking about the pitching rotation, I mean, I still am concerned that we don't have a bona fide number two. And until we have a bona fide number two, we're going to be a team of hope rather than a team of confidence going into the season. Now, there's a lot of names out there. There's a lot of people on the board. You're talking about a possibility of seven or eight guys being in the mix for the rotation. But again, question marks, guys. Well, they're all question marks. They're talking about Colon and Garcia possibly returning, either both or one of them. Listen, man, I don't know what to tell you. I think they surprised the shit out of me. I think they did a great job. I was very, very happy with what you got out of them. I thought Larry Rothschild did a great job in getting as much possible as we can get out of these guys, and I was happy with the job they did. But we didn't win with them. We did not win with them, and they both tailed off at the end of the year. More Colon. You want to say it's because of the injury, maybe. I don't know, but these guys are both wrong side of 30. They're both, how do you say, not the most elite physical specimens, and I don't know. I like them. I think they did a good job, but I think we got to move on. I don't think that's the answer. So I think we still have to get a number two. I still think we have to get more interchangeable. We got to get some new blood in that lineup so that we can kind of mix things up a little bit. Because again, last year we overachieved. It's not a matter of just maintaining. It's a matter of us having to improve our team. So if we don't do that, I think that we're going to have an inflated self image of what we are, and next year could be worse than this year, and I don't want that to happen. So Cashman, please, I like what we did last year, but don't be stubborn. Go out and get somebody, make some moves, shake some things up, and let's do something here. Top 10 Yankee players from 1981 to 1984, the garbage years, in order of how, you know, basically the criteria is how good of Yankees they were. Some of them may have had better careers other places. Just basically overall the best Yankees through those years. Number 10, to me, Mel Hall. Talented guy, driven out of town for one reason, because he used to pick on Bernie Williams. Number 9, Don Baylor. A lot of teams, journeyman player, just an overall good guy with a little bit of power, famous for getting hit with the baseball. Number 8, Mike Pagliarulo, just a good Yankee third baseman, a solid guy who held that position down for a bunch of years. Number 7, Jesse Barfield, a lot of good years with the Blue Jays, but also a lot of good years with the Yankees, one of the best arms out there, good power hitter, good guy to have around. Number 6, Danny Tartable, underachiever by standards of what we thought we were going to get out of him based on what we were paying him, but still, a good guy that you can count on for 30 and 100 for the times that he was here. Number 5, Roberto Kelly, one of my favorite Yankees at the time. I was so pissed off when we traded him for Paul O'Neill. Obviously, it was the right move, was a great move, and was a key move to put us over the top to win World Series, but it doesn't change the fact that Roberto Kelly was a pretty good damn player. A lot of speed, hit for average, decent defense. Number 4, Steve Sax. hit for good average, was fast, decent second baseman, except for the fact that he had throwing problems. But Steve Sachs was that guy, that scrappy guy, that he was maybe our version of like the Lenny Dykstra type of player. And then you got your superstars, basically, now. Number three, Ricky Henderson. You know what he could do, one of the greatest baseball players of all time. Number two, Dave Winfield, my first ever favorite Yankee. I've actually met him once. Very nice guy, imposing figure, swung out of his shoes. I mean, he just blasted line drives. He's 6 foot six, 230 pounds, and swung the bat with, I mean, bad intentions every time he got up. Great, great player. Great arm as well. He was famous for getting that first really big contract, that $20 million contract, I think it was. And that was a joke, obviously. $20 million for, was it 10 years? And it was, like, huge back in the 80s. Now it's pennies. And the number one, I think it's no surprise here, one of my favorite Yankees, and a lot of people of this era's favorite Yankee. So disappointed for him that he never got a chance to win a World Series. He basically was around for every Yankee team that didn't win the World Series in the last 25 years. But a great guy, great baseball player, MVP, batting champion, hit the hell out of the ball all the time, had a lot of doubles, RBI guy, and surprising power for a guy his size, Donnie Baseball, Don Mattingly. Thanks a lot, guys. Please check out Yankees and Gravy on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter at Yankees and Gravy. Check out our YouTube channel. Subscribe to this channel that you're watching right now. Thanks again. Have a happy Thanksgiving, and we will talk to you guys soon.